Good afternoon and welcome. And welcome to the people praying with us at home. We're celebrating the seventh Sunday in Ordinary Time. And we welcome today Father John Moyna, who's presiding at our liturgy, celebrating Mass with us.
Please stand as we sing number 547 in the green gather hymnal under your chairs.
Thank you. Let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Turning to the Lord, aware of our faults and sinfulness, we trust in his mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Spiritual things, we may carry out in both word and deed that which is pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the whole Israelite community and tell them, 'Be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall not bear hatred for your brother or sister in your heart, though you may have to reprove your fellow citizen. Do not incur sin because of him. Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against any of your people. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, did you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for the temple of God, which you are, is holy. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you considers himself wise in this age, let him become a fool so as to become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in the eyes of the Lord. For it is written, God catches the wise in their own ruses. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. So let no one boast about human beings, for everything belongs to you, Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world of life or death, or the present or the future, all belong to you, and you to Christ, and Christ to God. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, offer no resistance to one who is evil. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other one as well. If anyone wants to go to law with you over your tunic, hand him your cloak as well. Should anyone press you into service for 1 mile, go for 2 miles. Give to the one who asks of you, and do not turn your back on one who wants to borrow. You have heard that it was said, you shall You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father. For he makes his sun rise on the bad and the good, and causes rain to fall on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what recompense will you have? Do not the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brothers only, what is unusual about that? Do not the pagans do the same? So, be perfect, just as your heavenly Father is perfect. The Gospel of the Lord. Today's readings challenge us in regard to the way we manage our relationships with others, especially those who have harmed us. Leviticus there insists that because of God's holiness within us, we have the capability to love our neighbor as ourselves. This is more clearly defined in the reading from Matthew's Gospel, where neighbor is extended to mean one's enemies. If none of this makes sense, that should really be no great surprise. St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians states, "The wisdom of the world is foolishness in the eyes of God." Elizabeth will now offer some further thoughts on these passages.
Today's readings are full of advice on Christian living. As Father said, some of it challenging to hear or imagine integrating into one's life. So it seems to me. To some of this, I can say, okay, I can love my enemies if I don't have to like them. I don't mind giving away my tunic and cloak to someone who doesn't have the resources to protect themselves from the cold. However, I have always felt particularly sensitive about the instruction to turn the other cheek. I think this has excused abusive behavior through the centuries, has condemned faithful men and women who experienced domestic violence, for example, to remain in those situations. Is this really what Jesus meant? I asked myself. Then the passage from Mark's Gospel about Jesus' interaction with the Syrophoenician woman comes to mind. She, a nameless Gentile, intruded on Jesus' quiet time to beg him to heal her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not right to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." Ouch. Jesus called this poor woman and her daughter dogs. This was not Jesus' best day. Her response could have been to slink away, wounded and whimpering, or she could have given back as she received, trading insult for insult. But that is not the choice she made. The Syrophoenician woman had a significant goal, the healing of her daughter. She would not be deterred from the quest. She replied, "Sir, even the dogs under the table get the children's crumbs." In our first reading, Leviticus advised, "You may have to reprove your fellow citizen." The Syrophoenician woman received the verbal slap and turned the other cheek, accepting the insult with humility and making herself vulnerable again for the sake of her daughter. With a transformed perspective, Jesus promised the child had been healed. Throughout the Bible, we hear of God's preference for a humble, contrite heart. This is what the Syrophoenician woman demonstrated. Dominican scripture scholar Benedict Viviano offers the observation that the teaching in Matthew's gospel, foreshadowed in the reading from Leviticus, is part of a progression in biblical wisdom on how to deal with conflict. The book of Genesis allowed vengeance in response to wrongs. Deuteronomy qualified what was acceptable by limiting the amount of retribution to equivalency, only one eye for an eye. Tobit advised, do not do to others what you would not have done unto you. Two negatives create a positive. So we hear elsewhere in Matthew's gospel, do to others as you would have them do unto you. This is the gold standard for our behavior. St. Paul understands that worldly wisdom can run counter to Christian teaching. However, the wisdom of the world is foolishness in the eyes of God, he wrote to the Corinthians. Historically, nonviolent resistance has been a successful strategy for accomplishing societal change. Both Gandhi and, following his example, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., used it to achieve great goals. They also fell victim to the forces of evil. We can't turn away from that, but we can appreciate the good that was accomplished and important lessons taught through their efforts. If we look to the example of Jesus, whom Gandhi took as his model, we see someone without a political agenda. His mission was to proclaim the good news, to call people to repentance. He healed the sick in mind, body, and spirit, and taught the Father's way of perfection, the Beatitudes, and care for one's neighbors. However, theologian Elizabeth Johnson noted, he need not have called for violent insurrection in order to have been perceived as politically disruptive. The manner of his death was scandalous. Jesus was not just dead, but publicly disgraced. His movement shattered. The wisdom of the world would have judged Jesus and his mission a failure. And yet, here we are, 2,000 years later. I believe the foundation for understanding what this means for us today comes from St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians and God's word to Moses. These reveal how God perceives us, perhaps why God has not given up on us. From Leviticus, we hear that in God's eyes, we are a holy people because God, our Creator, is holy. We share in God's essence. Do we feel holy? Maybe sometimes, but often I would guess not. Nonetheless, despite what one's self-perception may be, God always has the last word. We are holy, not of our own doing, but because of God's goodness. St. Paul tells the Corinthians, I'm by extension us, that we are God's temple. We are God's sacred space. God's Spirit abides in us, within us. Are we aware of that indwelling, the Spirit's presence? Possibly, when we receive an out-of-the-blue inspiration to do something good or courageous, but other times, we may lose touch with the knowledge of that great gift. To appreciate the directives in the gospel, we must begin by accepting that we are precious in God's eyes. God's love for us and within us is infinitely holy. Consequently, God asks a great deal of us. Much will be required of the person entrusted with much. In the gospel, Jesus commands, do not resist evildoers. Turn the other cheek. Respond to a legal challenge by giving more than required. Love one's enemies. Do not hate. Can we really live this way, so contrary to the typical expectations of today's social environment of vitriol and retribution? Can we say yes to the call to nonviolence in today's scriptures? Can we trust that the holiness God has given us makes this possible? Can we believe ourselves capable of this because God abides within? That we are God's temple, the dwelling place of God's Spirit. Can we act as it appears that God desires us to act? If the answer is maybe, I'd like to try, let's not overwhelm ourselves with expectations. Following the wise guidance of Alcoholics Anonymous, may we seek to do this one event, one day at a time.
Together we profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. As we gather, we bring the many needs and cares that weigh heavily on our hearts and on our minds, and in confidence, we place them before our Heavenly Father.
That all Christians realize that grudges and revenge are poison, but loving others remains love in all circumstances. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That national leaders are roused by the massive earthquake in Turkey and Syria to improve preparations for disaster responses in their own countries. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we in our parish are willing to receive wisdom by listening to the people struggling on the edges of the community, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people continue to generously provide aid to Turkey and Syria, and that efficient infrastructure may be established to quickly and responsibly distribute that aid, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the spirit of healing will enter into all who are sick, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Michael Harrison, Sister Kevin John Shields, Teresa Cici, and all who have died may be enfolded in God's love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the needs written in our book of intentions and those we hold in our hearts are met. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, hear us. These prayers and notes known to you in the silence and depths of our hearts. As always, we make them through Christ our Lord.
Amen. I invite you now, if you brought an offering, to place it in the baskets at the base of the altar platform. If you prefer to give online, you may do so by going to our website or app and clicking the donate button.
May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love. This we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed us in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And so with all of the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim in song. Gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant, Francis our Pope, Edward our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of
the Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
May we share with those nearest a sign of his peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that we may experience the effects of the salvation which is pledged to us by the sacred mysteries. This we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Thank you for your support for the chili cook-off and bake sale. $1,679 was raised. The winner of the, Jim Bilkind was, his chili was proclaimed the best of the bunch. There were 14 kinds of chili and they were all good, so I don't know how people reached a conclusion. But anyway, and the winning recipe will be in next week's bulletin. Our Adult Faith Formation Committee is sponsoring a series exploring the various Catholic Christian spiritualities. March 4th, there will be a presentation on Dominican spirituality at the Dominican Retreat and Conference Center. That will be from 2 to 4. Transportation will be available from our parking lot if you prefer to have a ride rather than drive. Information's in the bulletin. The Invincibles, a newly formed group seeking to offer spiritual and social opportunities to people in the 20 to 40-year-old age range, is sponsoring the documentary, The Sisters of Selma, and this will be shown to all who would like to attend. They're just sponsoring it. Saturday, February 25th, next Saturday, 6:30 p.m. after this Mass, and there'll be an opportunity for discussion and light refreshments. And as I said, it's open to all. Lent starts this Wednesday. We have Ash Wednesday Mass at noon and Liturgy of the Word with Conferral of Ashes at 6 p.m. and also Holy Communion. And also the little black books that are offered as a Lenten devotional are available at the doorways. And there's also a little purple book that's for children or families to use. We have upcoming art retreats Monday, February 20th. And then again, February 23rd, and you can still attend even though they're very soon. It's okay for walk-ins, and information is in the bulletin. With regard to support for Turkey and Syria, I had announced at one of the masses, because a parishioner told me that warm clothing and blankets were being received at a facility on Broadway. However, they have completed their collection of those items. So if you would like to provide support to Syria and Turkey in their recovery, you can go to Catholic Relief Services, crs.org, www.crs.org, and make a donation. They are always already on the ground in troubled areas of our world, so they were ready to leap into motion when the earthquake took place. Not next Wednesday, but the Wednesday after March 1st, we begin our Wednesday evening stations, followed by Simple Supper, and volunteers are needed to both provide part of the meal and also to help with cleanup and setting up. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries or other significant events to note? May you enjoy a blessed week. And thank you, Father Moyna, for being with us this evening.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.